Buying films secondhand is a great way to own a great movie at an affordable price. Places like charity shops, CEX, cash converters, and other similar shops sell films at prices that are so low they might as well be giving them away for free. So me and a couple of my friends decided to make the most of this by buying three films at random that we hadn't seen before in the 50p section at CEX. And I decided to make a series out of this idea where I review the films we get. Let's see how long we keep our sanities. First up, we have the film that I chose, The Prince and the Surfer. Just from the cover alone, I knew this would be epic, and I was right. This film is essentially just The Prince and the Pauper story, but to the extreme. This film is the most 90s thing I think I've ever seen. It starts in this place called Gelfland with the Prince Edward. In Gelfland, everyone is American, but with really bad British accents, except for his mother, the Queen, who just seems to refuse to have tried to do a different accent and just speaks normally. Gelfland's minister, played by Robert Englund, for some reason is evil, which we know because whenever he's on screen, super sinister music starts playing. Edward's life is really hard because he's not allowed to travel or be his own man. Plus, he's being forced into an arranged marriage with a random girl called Galena, and she's bad because she acts snooty but really wants to live dangerously and date a bad boy. Edward's mother, Queen Albertina, a name I doubt anyone has had in the last 500 years, takes everyone to America for a trade treaty. But not just anywhere in America, Southern California, where all the skater dudes hang out at the beach and do all that shit. Edward's Californian doppelganger, Cash, or Tom as the DVD for some reason calls him, is bored of living in California and wants to leave to start a surf shop or something. He is a radical skater dude and has multiple skating montages. Cash is a rebel, but it seems everyone knows who he is. There's a scene where he crashes his skateboard into someone's car and has this like weird conversation. It seems like the character is going to become this key character in the film, but then he vanishes.
Guess I don't have to push with my feet to make it go.
I mean, isn't that how you use the pedals on a car, or do you have some like tiny person pushing it for you? He's also best friends with a guy who's clearly in his 30s and Freaks and Geeks era Linda Cardellini. Cash's dad Johnny is played by Timothy Bottoms, whose career really took a tumble in the 90s. He's an ex-surfer and ex-cop, however he doesn't do either anymore for some reason.
Hey Cash.
He's an insurance seller, but he has this subplot where he becomes a security guard for the Queen. When he gets his security job, he has this really weird interview with these two guys who act like weird detectives, and it's like the most awkward scene in the movie. And to make matters worse, they bring the characters back multiple times and do basically the exact same scene again. In fact, they're wearing the same clothes and it's the same room, so it's very likely that they filmed it all in the same day to save money. There's also this weird like Twin Peaks music playing underneath, which makes the scene feel super Lynchian. The golden colouring and lighting all looks very Twin Peaks-esque, and it's completely different from anything else in the movie. After this scene, Edward and Galena share a car together because it's the only way Edward can convince people to let him leave his mansion they're staying in.
Lady Galena.
Uncle
Constance.
Edward.
Donkey!
Galena stands out of the sunroof to wave to no one, which Cash sees in the distance. Thinking she looks hot, he gets on a skateboard and rides after them. Galena sees him, and because he's a cool bad boy, she gets all horny. Am I really allowed to say that? Because she's like a fucking child. Cash follows them back to the estate and breaks in, which is surprisingly easy to do. You would have thought if the Queen of a country was staying there, they would have more security guards around. Although two people in clearly cheap police fancy dress follow him, once he hides behind a counter and they can't see him, they just run away like nothing happened. I didn't realize this kid was a master of stealth.
What do you think you're doing?
Cash.
You don't have enough to keep you busy. Try to remember the mission if you can.
Cash goes upstairs to try and find Galena, which leads to him bumping into Edward in a scene which features some of the worst acting I've ever seen. Also, there's a clear cut on the screen where they cut two shots together, which shows every time the two characters are shown on screen together. It's hilarious every time. It's like a line throughout the whole screen. They then decide to do the whole swapping lives thing, which would make sense if they both spoke with the same accent, but they don't, and it's literally questioned once performance by Linda Cardellini's character later on. It's so dumb. Edward tries to skate away but falls over in a low XD slapstick scene. He then clumsily knocks into loads of people when a guy thinks he's trying to steal his car and tries to beat him to death with a wheel lock. Linda Cardellini shows up, and because this guy is actually really nice, he waits for her to pick Edward up, fall over with him, and then get up and start running before he starts chasing them. Very considerate of him. Eventually, he just decides to stop chasing him for some reason, and the scene ends. Cash finds that the servants will copy anything he does and decides to make them do funny dances because comedy. And then because Edward doesn't have a key to his house and his dad works for literally the rest of the movie without ever taking a single break or ever going back home again, he has to sleep on the doorstep. There's then this really weird scene where Albertina wakes up, calls Edward's name, and then checks in on him as he sleeps. It's like she was expecting him to wake up in the bed with her. Guess she liked a bit of late night mum and son action. Jesus, why have I written so many fucking paedophile jokes in this script? She goes outside and meets Johnny. She then lies about being royal because I guess she doesn't want him treating her differently or something. It doesn't really make a lot of sense since she spends the whole movie relishing the fact that everyone treats her like royalty. Surely if she finds this guy attractive, she can be like, I'm the queen, come fuck me, and he would. Like, he's not going home anytime soon. I don't think we ever actually see the house ever again after this. We then find out Robert England's evil plan to turn Gelfland into a Golfland, a large mini golf island. Yeah, for some reason he wants to uproot the 4,000 homes, including his own in Gelfland, and create a large golfing island because... why the fuck not, I guess. Edward admits to Linda Cardellini that he isn't Cash, and she doesn't believe him and gets angry because he said some nice things to her and now it's like he's taking it back. They eventually end up flirting and shit because, of course, it's a boy and a girl. They have to get together. That's just the way films work. Then Chase manages to convince Galena to come in and they spend the day doing bad things together, like throwing socks at each other and opening the curtains.
It's so big.
Cash and Edward call each other and Robert England is listening in. Does he just listen to everyone's conversations, or did he just happen to guess that Edward had swapped places with someone and he was just waiting by the phone just in case? Or maybe he just happened to know that someone would be calling him at that exact moment. He just has really great timing. He sends his cops to kidnap Edward and Linda Cardellini, and then he makes Cash sign a treaty which will allow him to transform Gelfland to the Golfland. Of course, I don't know why the prince has to sign it when he also gets the queen to sign it later on. Then when he's sitting in his room, Galena comes in and throws a diamond at a security guard's head, probably killing him or giving him brain damage. I especially love how delayed his falling to the ground is. It's such a hilarious moment. Edward and Linda Cardellini escape. There's this weird chase scene across a mini golf course where Robert England goes to give the papers to the person who needs the treaty to turn Gelfland into Golfland. Then the two boys tell the queen the truth. Robert England sets his cops on them, but Galena slaps one and Linda Cardellini goes full Last of Us 2 and probably kills one by beating him with a golf club. Robert England quickly gives the guy the papers and takes the suitcase of money. Then the queen hits him with a golf club, causing him to fall over and revealing that instead of money, he was given golf balls because they misunderstood him on the phone. They thought he said, give me Gelfland. He said, give me Gelfland dollars or something, and he got a suitcase of golf balls. I don't know how you can, like, mishear that, but that's a thing that happens for some reason. Just pure hilarity, clearly. After that, everyone moves to Gelfland because I guess none of the people that lived in America needed to go to school and had no family or friends that they really cared about. Edward and Linda Cardellini get together, Cash and Galena get together, and Johnny and the Queen get together. Everyone lives happily ever after, except Robert England, who realized that kids' movies are degrading for actors and somehow more embarrassing than acting in zombie strippers or strippers versus werewolves. Don't know why he decided to act in horror movies about strippers, but I guess times are tough. So overall, Prince and the Surfer is the greatest movie I've ever seen. It has romance, it has skateboarding, it has comedy, it has Robert Englund. If only it actually had surfing like the fucking title says it does. Next up we have The Polar Bear King, directed by Ola Sulam, otherwise known as Robert Benton according to the DVD cover. I don't know why they advertised a completely unrelated director as the director of this movie, but this DVD is by the same company who got the main character's name on the Prince and the Surfer DVD wrong. Looking at the blurb, you know you're in for a great time. In a land far, far away, a jealous witch turns a king into a bear. The bear travels to another faraway land and meets a fox. Of course, the foxy princess falls for the bear right off the bat and runs off with him to the marriage bed. If you want to find out if the couple live happily ever after and defeat the evil queen, see this film. Well, that settles that then. I will not be watching this movie. The film starts with a completely unnecessary scene of a couple of guys on a horse being chased by a pack of wolves, which are clearly just played by husky dogs. It serves no purpose to the plot at all. It just seems to be there because the director hates wolves and wanted to see one get hit by a torch and die. So the story is based on a Nordic fairy tale called White Bear King Valamon. There are two different kingdoms, one called Winterland and the other called Summerland. The king of Winterland has the power to speak to wolves, and all of Winterland is surrounded by wolves. Explains why we just saw a guy from the land set one on fire. The king has three daughters, two of which are apparently cunts, and the other one who is the cool one, I guess. Because the king is a bit of a dick, he clearly favors the cool one, who according to IMDb is just called Princess. She fantasizes of meeting a beautiful man that she can fall in love with and live in a flowery place with, which leads to the narrator spoiling the movie by saying that she will literally do exactly this. In Summerland, we see the newly appointed King Valamon, who is visited by a witch. The witch desires to become his wife, but because he refuses, she decides to turn him into a polar bear, maybe the greatest transformation sequence in any movie ever made. She must take rejections really, really badly if any time someone does it, she turns them into a polar bear. Basically, the king is forced to be a polar bear for 7 years, except for like midnight to 6 a.m. or something when he turns back into a man. However, if during that time someone sees his face, then he's forced to marry the witch or some shit. He goes on a journey as a polar bear and meets the princess and explains his situation. But the whole time, he sounds like he's in pain.
Because I'm not a polar bear. I'm the king.
Like, apparently being a polar bear is super painful and it makes speaking English really difficult. He gives her this necklace that he's only allowed to give to the one he marries. Maybe he shouldn't be giving it to a stranger that he's just met. Like, he doesn't even know if she wants to marry him. He could have just given it to a stranger who is like, I'm not fucking marrying a polar bear. Like most sane people probably would. He then vanishes and says he'll be back in 3 days for some reason.
I met a beautiful white bear who's not really a bear. Actually, he's a king under a spell.
Yeah, not gonna lie, if my daughter came home telling me this, I think I would have her sectioned. Also, I forgot to mention that I'm pretty sure 90% of this film is dubbed over in English, and it's especially obvious with the king because he sounds like Sam Eagle from The Muppets.
Don't you understand, dear? He only wants you for his next meal.
It is the British way.
So the king and his lackeys all decide to guard the kingdom from the polar bear and keep his daughter safe. This leads to probably the greatest scene in any movie ever made. The polar bear attacks the villagers and tries to get the daughter. The problem is the puppet effects are horrendous. Me and the guys I watched it with were almost in tears from how ridiculous it looked. And it's a shame because Jim Henson's Creature Shop worked on it. And I know some of their effects can be very hit or miss, but this is easily the worst work they've ever done. And I thought the face inside the mouth in Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles was bad. Yeah! Eventually, the princess gets on his back and is taken away, and I guess at that point, everyone just gives up and lets her go. The polar bear then takes her to his castle in the Summerland, and how a polar bear can survive in heat, I have no idea. So from then on, the prince comes in at night and they bang, but it has to be in the dark so she can't see his face. The princess gives birth, but the witch comes in planning to kill it or something. So in order to save it, the king's mum, who is a ghost, turns the baby into a ghost or something. Basically, she was like, I'm not gonna let you kill this baby, so I'm gonna kill it myself to protect it from you. The witch then comes in dressed as a Power Rangers character and just basically goes, I'm evil, you will never win, blah, blah, blah. After this, she gets pregnant and gives birth to twins, but then the exact same thing happens again. The ghost mum takes the babies to protect them. It was really hilarious.
What has happened to our children?
The princess gets super depressed and refuses to move until she's brought a snowball from her homeland. They wrapped it up in loads of cloth and stuff, which somehow kept it frozen. That is definitely how heat works. The king says that she should go home and visit her family, but if her sister offers her a present, she shouldn't accept it. So then she not only ignores him and accepts the gift of a candle, but when she comes back, she uses it to see the king's face, which she was told not to do. And of course, this causes the witch to take him away. It makes no sense why after all of this, he still wants to get with the princess. Like, she literally disobeyed you and caused you to have to marry the witch. Like, even though she saves you in the end, like, still, like, I wouldn't get back with someone after doing that. She runs away and for some reason starts, like, climbing through a river, even though there are literally huge paths surrounding her that she could take. In fact, eventually she does start taking it, so it literally makes no sense. The king's mum appears with the children and tells the princess to follow her. One of the kids uses magic scissors to create a new dress for her, which looks so obviously reversed that it's pretty hilarious. They also give her magic boots, which allow her to climb up the mountain, which leads to the witch's castle, which is very obviously just the ground, but they've tilted the camera to make it look like she's going up. I especially likes when she falls up the side of the mountain. She eventually gets up there and meets Hagrid, who explains that the witch and the king are getting married the next day and they need to rescue him. He disguises her as a boy, so the witch thinks that she's just a worker. Meanwhile, the witch is cooking up some crystal meth or something in a lab, which includes stones which light up, which actually looks kind of cool. Then the devil shows up, who looks like Frank Turner dressed up as Robin Hood and painted his face white. The witch hears the princess whistling and making a dress with her magic scissors. She then asks her to make her a dress. However, she instantly knows it's the princess, making the whole dressing up as a boy thing completely fucking pointless. She then drugs the king to knock him out and tells her to make him a suit or something.
I saw her give something to the king that made him sleep.
Yeah, so did she? She was standing right there. Did you not see her there? Hagrid helps the princess up into the witch's lab and sees that the witch is making a potion to make the king fall in love with her. When she leaves, the princess makes her own potion, which apparently she just happens to know how to do. Literally, I have no clue how she knows how to make potions, but apparently she does. She drops it and Hagrid catches it, which somehow turns his hair grey. Literally, no clue how that happened. They never explain it, but He's just grey now. The prince pretends to drink the potion and then starts acting like he loves the witch and hates the princess. The princess then tells the witch that the potion she made is actually wine, even though it looks yellow and is in a large potion bottle. I literally just read this script and I put, but really the wine poison. But really, the wine is poison, and it makes everyone at the wedding explode. After this, the king is free from the spell, him and the princess reunite with their children, and they head back to Winterland for a nice family reunion. And that was The Polar Bear King, a film that, although occasionally hilarious, was pretty dull for the most part. There were some cool shots here and there, and as a cute folktale to show your kids, it's fine, I guess. But aside from that, I couldn't recommend it to anyone. But hey, it was better than the final movie we watched. Paranormal Ascendancy is quite possibly the worst movie I've ever seen in my life. Originally called 3am from what I can tell, it was renamed Paranormal Ascendancy when it received a UK DVD release to capitalise on the huge paranormal activity hype in the early 2010s. The film reminds me a lot of Birdemic, a zero budget movie that was made by people who were completely incompetent filmmakers. But unlike Birdemic, which was pretty hilarious, 90% of this movie is just painful to watch. I think the only positive thing I have for the entire movie is that they just about managed to press record on the camera. Everything that you could do wrong is done terribly in this movie. The acting is horrendous, the script is even worse, the sound mixing and dubbing is worse than a Christopher Nolan movie, the film looks ugly, the editing is terrible, everything about the film is terribly done. I'm pretty sure most of the scenes were recorded using the on-camera microphone because everyone sounds terrible. It's like watching amateur porn. It's also very obvious they used a cheap camera because it looks like early YouTube quality. The film's about a guy called Michael who was also the film's screenwriter, big surprise there. While at a gathering with a bunch of his friend Kenny says that he's haunted by a ghost that comes to him every night at 3 a.m. At least I'm pretty sure that's what he says because the voices keep being drowned out by the music, and when the music isn't drowning out their voices, the voices are super loud and distorted. Michael drives home with his girlfriend, but the sound effect they used for his car was clearly not long enough, so they start it from the beginning multiple times, but each time make it slightly louder. This is something that happens so many times throughout the film, it's hilarious. There's even a moment where someone's bed sheets are louder than anything else in the entire movie.
Thanks.
They have a conversation which similarly keeps changing levels randomly multiple times. Like sometimes they'll be talking and suddenly it gets super quiet and then suddenly it'll be blisteringly loud. It's like they weren't even trying. Michael goes to Kenny's house ready for the ghost. They have this awkward conversation which seems really badly improvised. The radio then comes on and the lights start flickering and making weird static electrical noises. Michael unplugs everything but the TV turns itself on.
A ghost!
The radio then starts answering math questions, which has clearly just been done by changing the channel on there. Michael then wakes up from a dream and thinks about his ex and puts down this picture frame of his girlfriend, but for some reason it's this really loud booming sound effect. It's so unnecessary. The next day, his sister Annie wakes him up by shouting so loud that the camera distorts the sound.
Annie! Wake up!
After this, loads of weird things start happening at exactly 3:33, like this weird creepy banana thing existing. They then go to this weird restaurant where I'm pretty sure the film's only black characters reside. And when I say black characters, I mean nearly every single person in this restaurant is black. It's like they were like, oh shit, our cast is all white, we need some diversity. It's a pointless scene because it only exists to show Kenny say, you can't come see the ghost today, and then them convince him to let them come over. It's so dumb. They go to Kenny's to see the ghost, and while they're there, they're magically transported to Blue Land, where the only color is blue for some reason. The audio in this scene is super muffled, and for some reason, there's strangers who talk in these really low-pitched voices that, like, are completely impossible to understand. Then a hooded guy starts appearing, and then they try to run away from him, but they basically just run back and forth, and he keeps appearing. It's so hilarious. Then some guy appears and says everything's going to happen on September 3rd, you have to find the twin flame, leading me to wonder, what the fuck are you talking about? In the car, Michael says that he needs to meet up with his ex-girlfriend because he saw a pen which was a clue to what's happening and they met because of a pen or some shit. He then has like this emotional flashback of when they broke up, I think. I don't really have any clue what happened. And because it's a flashback, they smudged the camera to make it look blurry and dreamy, but it looks so bad. And then there's this random scene where he's riding a motorbike and Sum 41 starts playing. Like, did Sum 41's label know about this? Because I'm 1000% sure they didn't have the money to pay to license this song. And then there's this hilarious spooky dream where Annie has a blindfold on and a knife. Michael, Kenny, and Annie decide to go to the psychic for some reason. She speaks a load of nonsense while Kenny and Annie sing Christmas songs in the waiting room, also for some reason. But look out, because Gothic Girl is here, the best character in the movie, because she hisses at people.
Shh. I'm sorry, Emmett. Shut the fuck up, bitch.
The psychic explains what a twin flame is. It's essentially like a soulmate, but more powerful, right? That explains everything. It's basically two people who share a soul, and if they meet, their love is so powerful that it overcomes all evil.
That's f***ing gay. He needs f***ing gay as hell.
Michael comes out to find Gothic Girl getting angry because Annie was looking at her drawings. Then the video cuts out for a few seconds for some reason. They tell Michael to go see his ex because they're twin flames, I guess. He arrives at her house and Sean Kingston is playing once again. No way they had the rights to that song. All the girls start flirting with him, which I'm pretty sure only happens because the writer wanted to have girls flirt with him. He sees his ex and runs after her, only for the music to just abruptly cut out. He says that she should find him if she wants to get back with him. Then it cuts into this weird series of images, which is hilariously out of nowhere. And then they meet up on a bridge and decide to get back together. Like, what was the point in that last scene if they weren't even going to get together till they met at some bridge? And also, what happened to his current girlfriend? Like, are they broken up? Like, she didn't say this is over. She's like, I'm done and left. Like, did he not message her or anything? Is he just completely ignored her and pretended that she doesn't exist anymore? Kenny then arrives with Annie blindfolded in the car. He pulls a knife to her and says that the ghost is on his way. Then they all go back to Blue Land, and that random guy from earlier shows that he too was told to see this ghost by Kenny. Then he had this ghost spirit merge with his body. But because he died, the spirit is now free and he wants to merge it with someone else. Michael pretends to have merged only to punch him and save Annie. The spirit then arrives and I guess it merges with Kenny. This then leads to an incredibly exciting car chase. Eventually they catch up and fight each other. Michael beats him to a bloody pulp, and then they're transported to Blue Land, where the spirit starts appearing everywhere they go again, like an Enderman or something. Michael then uses this rock that was like something he got from his girlfriend or something, and he defeats the spirit with it because she is his twin flame and their love defeats all evil. Then I'm freed, and Michael then says if he sees Kenny again, he'll kill him. I especially love this scene because it was obviously overdubbed with a cheap microphone, and the actor's mouth was super close to it as well.
If I ever see you again, I'll kill you.
They then all go to the beach and have a good time, and that's the end of their story. There's then a scene of a Gothic girl convincing some guy to come see the ghost in her place. Then Superstition by Stevie Wonder plays during the ending credits, which look really blurry and are basically unreadable. The biggest problem with Paranormal Ascendancy, past the very, very obvious, is that despite being so incompetent, this film is really boring. There are many laugh out loud moments, but the film is just more dull than anything. If you want a really badly made horror movie that is of this amateur quality but actually funny, then I recommend watching Birdemic instead. Since this, the director and screenwriter have basically done nothing. I literally couldn't find anything about the director past the fact that he directed another movie in 2008, but the screenwriter has actually gone on to do quite a lot of non-film related stuff, mostly in TV editing and stuff like that. So good for him, I guess. I honestly would not be surprised if it turned out this film was literally just like a student film, or a film just made by a bunch of friends that was never planned to be released anywhere, but somehow it got this big release to capitalize on the Paranormal Activity craze. If you ever see it in a shop, I would recommend not getting it, even if it was as cheap as 50p, because it's just such a waste. Overall, this 50p marathon experience was actually a lot of fun, and I look forward to doing it again. Hopefully next time the quality of selections is a lot better, but honestly, I don't think anything will ever top Prince and the Server, which, as I said, is the greatest movie ever made.